you could be seated this morning. We're looking forward to a great day together. We're going to have two sessions this morning with Pastor Jeffrey, and he's going to be introducing Jared to us. And I'm excited to hear a little more from Jared because he's a rural church pastor who has planted four churches, right? Five, six churches, okay. And, you know, it just helps for us to hear what God is doing through other people to reach the surrounding area. Last night I was encouraged to hear several pastors in our group say, you know, this is what I'm praying for. Here's a community 30 miles away. Here's one 40 miles away with no church. And we eventually are going to plant there. And I just pray that God will give you some wonderful ideas of how you can expand the kingdom of God to reach more people. So it is an honor this morning. Ladies, let me quick announcement. 3 o'clock today, coffee, and you've got the room copper 4 and 5. So we invite you to 3 o'clock, ladies, to come and be a part of that. Would you welcome our friend Jeffrey this morning as he comes?
Right. Good morning, friends. Pastors, did you rest well? Come on, I'm so glad. I know that for many of you, you traveled a long way to be here. And I just want to reiterate again what a privilege it is to get this time together. You know, as I was praying about this, and this is not like a couple weeks ago, but like months ago in preparation for our time together, there's a couple things I felt like God said. This is a reoccurring theme in every community and every pastor's life. But it's been especially magnified in this last season. And so in the first session, I actually want to talk about how do we deal with discouragement? Has anyone ever been there? Like in the last 3 minutes, you know, whatever? So for me, I'm good for like 2 hours, right? And then something happens, or I say something, or I didn't say something, or... So I just want to talk like real practically. And I want to not just... I don't want to just... but I want to equip you because you're leading teams and you're leading your elders and your boards and you're loving your community. And so I'm excited for what God's going to do. I've been praying for you. Pray today would be life-giving and encouraging. And I was just thinking about discouragement. And so we launched New Hope Church, and we said we were going to give the best 20 years of our lives to this, and that's what we were doing. We were there for 7 years. And I would still be there today, candidly, if God hadn't redirected us. I'm still probably kind of a little Peter. Is anyone else going to be affected by that? Only if I do this, right? but I was thinking we would still be there if God hadn't redirected our steps. And I was sharing last night at dinner with Pastor Dave that, you know, for my wife and I, we're still in the season of mourning, not because of what we get to do. What a privilege and honor to serve pastors and leaders and troops and see God multiply the church, but we're mourning what we let go of. I mean, what we set, and it's God's church, we hold it like that. But man, discouragement sometimes just sneaks in. Discouragement doesn't call ahead, it kicks the door in. It doesn't like, hey, 2 weeks from now, I'm going to show up, you're going to have a really bad 2 days. Just adds up. That's not how discouragement works. Discouragement just sneaks in, right? So I'll give an example. Leading our church, about maybe 4 years into it, and one of our elders, amazing couple, calls, hey, let's do dinner. We're like, yeah, sounds great. This was not unusual. So sometimes when someone says, hey, let's have dinner, you're like, okay, right? You ever nervous with someone? You're like, you try to get, like, since through COVID, I was just like, is this good news or bad news? I just need to know. If you want us to come over, if you want us to do coffee, this was pre-COVID, right? So, they say, hey, let's, you know, go to this Mexican restaurant. I want to say this. This used to be my favorite Mexican restaurant, okay? So we sat down, and before the chips got there, you know how, like, they're really good at getting the chips involved in there? Before they even got there, they say, hey, listen, you know, Pastor Jeffrey, we want to tell you and Joanne that we're going to be leaving New Hope. I'm like, oh, you're moving? So I know he'd been looking at another job in another place. He was a hospital administrator. They said, no, we're not moving. It's like, oh, that's awesome. And then we're just going to go to a different church. Now, did I mention the tips hadn't got there yet? Right? So now I'm like, oh, I don't even like this restaurant anymore. Right? I was like, you could have just popped in my house. Hey, just to let you know. You know, no. So now house for another hour and 12 minutes. Like, how do you know? I looked at my watch. It wasn't, listen, they love Jesus. We're still great friends. But that was discouraging. And all of us have stories like that, and obviously much worse. Subtle, some are big, some are subtle. But discouragement is part of our journey of leadership. But you already know this, but when you sign up for leadership, you signed up to be discouraged occasionally. I didn't, that was the fine print. I'm good right now, Jamie, thank you. That was the fine print. If I had seen that, I probably wouldn't have thought it. But all of us have to figure out, how do we deal with this? How do we navigate? How do we move forward and progress? Because isn't it true, life doesn't stop? Your spouse still needs you. Your family needs you, which is your first ministry, by the way, those two. There's this myth, and actually I think it's an enemy's lie, that if you take care of the church, God takes care of your family. I think our first mission as the church is to our family. I believe that. Now, does God bless your kids? Does he take, of course. But then you get one parent. Multiple pastors. So discouragement sneaky. So I want to encourage. Now, I'll be impressed by saying this. I believe James 1, 2, 3, 4, consider it pure joy when you face trials of many kinds, because it's testing your faith. Develop perseverance. Woo! I believe that. Bible. I believe Philippians 1, 6. He who began a good work in you is going to be faithful to complete it. Yes! And. Not but. And. By the way, if you're in an argument or a robust conversation with your spouse, and you say, you know, honey, I'm really sorry, but you're really, what you're saying is, I'm not sorry. So I'm not saying but, I'm saying and, because those are all true. God's good. Jesus is Lord. We are on the winning team, and we all have to figure out, how do we deal with discouragement? So a couple of do's. Actually, there's going to be three do's, two don'ts. I'm going to start with the don'ts. Number one, don't deny it. My tendency as an optimist is to say, oh, you know what? I know. Things are good. Things are fine. We're going to be good. Now listen. If I'm choosing between pessimism and optimism, I always want to choose optimism. But we got to be careful not to deny what we're feeling or what's happening that's discouraging. And sometimes I was guilty, and maybe you are occasionally, of not addressing what's discouraging to us and our team, and you actually lose credibility. Here's what I wrote in my notes. Not addressing the obvious things that affect you and others will eventually deplete you and erode your credibility. They're like, of course that's discouraging. The people are ... So don't deny it. And, you know, we're of the, we just keep going, and we do need to keep working hard. We need to keep striving to honor God, but not to overcome or not to deceive ourselves into thinking, I'm not discouraged. Because the thing is, discouragement doesn't start as that. It starts as disillusionment. Something didn't go the way we want, well, the way we hoped or prayed or envisioned or what we put on paper, and all of a sudden the enemy starts to creep in and whisper. And I want to just listen, if you're discouraged today, it's okay to be discouraged. The question is, are you going to stay there? It's normal to start with fear. Fear is a natural place to start. We just can't stay there. Discouragement is part of the obstacle course called leadership and ministry. You know, it's not new. So, don't deny it. If the house is on fire, an option is like, let's do floors. Okay? Don't deny it, though. I mean, like, no, there's the smoke and stuff burning. We should deal with this, right? We could be so quick to say, you know, weeping may endure for the night, but joy comes in the morning. Yes, it does, and there's a whole book called Lamentations. Okay? Like, Lamentations is like, this is just bad. Have you read, like, two-thirds of the book of Job is them saying, where are you, God? What about the Psalms? I love how real and raw they are. Aren't you so grateful that the Bible doesn't put up these pretend fake facade people? I mean, so many, like, much of David's writing and other psalmists are like, this is just so tough. God, can you smite them? We need to bring that word back. I want to encourage you, read the word smite into your next message, okay? So avoiding or dismissing what discourages us doesn't deal with it. So the first thing is just don't deny it. So here's the question. What have you or I been denying? We need to start acknowledging. You don't even have to solve it right away. You just have to go, okay, I'm not going to deny that anymore. Here's number two. We don't. Don't dwell on it. It's not that you're not recognizing it, but you're also not going to camp there. And sometimes what happens is the enemy hijacks our heart and our mind because someone said something earlier or 2 weeks ago or a month ago, and we're still wrestling with it. I'm super good at winning arguments afterward, but they're not there. Like, oh boy. Woo! Okay, yeah, that's not godly leadership. That's like the fruit of the Spirit left the building. You ever want to use a black highlighter on the Bible? It's like the yellow highlighter, like, that's a great promise. Just, woo! Lord, yes, more, bring it. Black highlighter, don't want to do that. Don't want to do that. That's tough. We got to live it out. You don't live it out when you pretend everything's okay. But I'm also not going to dwell on it. What gets your attention determines your direction. And sometimes we look at something so long that the mountain is actually bigger than it really is because we get so close and we get so inundated by what discourages or distracts us. Your hope can get hijacked. I met with some pastors early on when we were starting New Hope. And I've been fortunate to have some incredible, what I would put in the lifelong friend category. Pastor Kevin here is one of those guys. And I met with this group of guys Thursday mornings for coffee at 6 a.m. Now, some of you are like, oh, that's kind of late. We've been up since 4. Okay, great. We'll get you a medal or something. But for us, we met at 6, okay? And so we met at 6, and Scott was 6, said to me, we're like a year in. Like, listen, one of the most important things you'll ever do is guard your emotional energy tank. And I'm like, oh, that sounds great. I didn't have a clue what he's really talking about. But isn't it true that there's things that deplete and pull away and erode some of the emotional energy we need to love and to lead well? Not just to love and lead well, but to be discerning to the Holy Spirit. And what happens is if my attention and affection gets too much on what's discouraging, I actually begin to mute the voice of God, and I elevate the voice of discouragement. Your emotional energy is something you have to guard. Listen, success and failure are both fatal if swallowed. Success, oh, I got this, we did this. Failure, there's weakness, nothing works ever. They're both fatal. You need a measure of both. So here's the question with, I'm not going to dwell on it. What have we been dwelling on that we need to move on from? Now, I wrote my notes here. Maybe you need to give yourself a set amount of time to think about it. And say, I'm not going to think about it. I'm going to give myself, and my wife, Joanne, has done this recently. She said, you know, she's dealt with some discouragement with the move and her job. Like, my job kept going, her job stopped. We left our boys, we left our family, we left our church, we left our house, all this stuff, right? So she's dealt with discouragement and actually to the point where she's been depressed a little bit. And we were praying together, and she has great friends, and she's, you know, getting some wise counsel. But she said, I made a decision the other day, and it kind of freed me up. She said, when the enemy whispers or a thought of discouragement pops in, she says, I'm going to give myself a set amount of time to think about that. And I'm going to pivot off of it. Like, I think that's called taking every thought captive and making it obedient to Christ. That's just biblical. That's in alignment with God's word. So give yourself a set amount of time to think about it. You're not going to deny it, so you are going to think about it, but you're also not going to dwell on it. And maybe either you need to move on or commit to come back to it later after you've given it some time to breathe. What have you been dwelling on? It's not that our people need us to never be discouraged, but they can't have us always discouraged. People pick up what's coming out of us. And, you know, I love that authenticity is a great way to honor God. But I would also caution you to be really mindful with who you share what with. I know you know this. I'm just wise counsel, wise leaders, godly men and women. Is there anything always great? Of course not. But I'm going to use an appropriate measure of vulnerability, because I know that if I can trust this group, I know if this is a group that can actually help me walk through and process. So maybe you say, I'm not going to dwell on it, but I'm going to pause it so I can come back to it to make sure that I'm not overlooking it. Okay, let's pivot to the positive. So I'm not going to deny it or dwell on it. What do I do? Pray. Do something about it. Like, think about this. The God of the universe says, I'd like to talk to you. We're like, okay, that's so hard, but I'm kind of busy. You ever thought, hey, I don't know what else to do, so I prayed. Guilty. There's times where I'm just like, oh, man, there's a leadership thing I'm working through right now. And there's times where I've, like, it's kind of hijacked my thoughts a little bit. And then the Holy Spirit, I think, just whispers, hey, why don't you pray? So you combat insecurity. We'll talk about that next session. You deal with discouragement through prayer. You leverage and lean into the presence and the power of God. Now, what's powerful about prayer is that you're inviting God into your story, and He's already fully invested. But isn't it powerful how the Holy Spirit gives some discernment and some wisdom? It's not on the screen, but Romans, Paul writes to the church in Rome. He says, don't copy the behaviors and customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. What are the customs of our world? Gossip? And when you're dealing with something or you're dealing with someone, you're like, oh, that's how the world responds. What we do as pastors is we go to prayer. We go to the direct source who gives wisdom and discernment and guides us as we navigate. I love what C.S. Lewis wrote, or someone from the internet. He said, or Abraham Lincoln, not sure, right? Okay. Or JFK. Okay. You can't go back and change the beginning, but you can start from where you are and change the ending. I'll say it this way. You can't go back, but you can go forward. So we go forward through prayer. Jesus says, ask and seek and knock. He says, come to me, all who are weary and heavy burdened. And what does He give us? Says, I go find rest for your souls. Prayer boldly declares our dependence on God. It reminds us inwardly and outwardly that dependence isn't weakness. It's actually wisdom. That I look to and I lean into Jesus. So here's a question on prayer. What have we been processing but we've not been praying about? And it's not that we don't think, because we need to think, but also there's a difference between thinking about something. Say, God, I'm just going to think out loud with you. We pray. Paul also writes to the church in Colossae, and I love, this has always been such an encouraging, he says, since you've been raised with Christ, set your hearts on things above. Prayer does that. Where Christ is seated at the right hand of God the Father, set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. Set your minds on things. Prayer sets our minds on Him. So what do I do if I'm dealing with discouragement? I'm not going to deny it. I'm not dwelling on it. I'm doing something about it. I'm going to pray. Here's the second thing. I'm going to process with a trusted friend. I need, sometimes, and I'm going to say this in the next session too, sometimes I need outside help to experience an inward transformation. Sometimes I need fresh eyes and a fresh perspective, because my lens can get so narrow in my world and my job and just how I think. And so I need some outside voices, trusted, godly, wise counsel to help me process. Bible says this, for with wise counsel you wage your own war. And in a multitude of counselors, there's safety. There's power in partnership. When I process with a trusted friend, I'm living out Proverbs 13:20. He who walks with the wise grows wise. But a companion of fools suffers harm. So we got to ask, who are the loudest voices and who are we processing our most important stuff with? I need to lean into what you need to lean into, and that's godly voices. I love the community that you have here. I love, Pastor, that you created space for people to connect and interact, and I know that will happen part of a relationship, you have to endure the risk connected to it. So, risk, rejection, in order to get the reward. Why? Because you're better together. We are better together. Now, I wrote down some thoughts as far as friends I think you need, but I'm on the screen. That way I'm not being held accountable for later, okay? So, not really, but here's the first thing. I think you need these five kind of friends. And I'm going to say there's an asterisk on the fifth one. You'll get it when we get there. Okay, here's the first one. You need a confidant. You need someone who you can be sharing with and processing and unfiltered with. By the way, I think we have to set conversational parameters. So sometimes, like, let's say I'm going to call Kevin, okay? And, like, I'm trying to get counsel from him, and he is immediately coming to celebrate something. I'm like, bro, I just need to just listen and then give me feedback. I'm setting conversational parameters, right? What I'm saying is, in this moment, I need a confidant. I need to be able to be unfiltered, as Pastor Les Welk refers to it, an unfiltered friend. Where I don't have to have a pretense, and I can just be fully me. We need a confidant. The next thing, we need a counselor. I'm actually 100% for Christian counseling, and we need wife counsel. We need people like that, just further along than we are. One of the reasons that I've invited Jared in the next session to take some of the time is he's an expert. He is a practitioner of rural ministry, of multiplication. Like, we multiply, but I don't get rural the way he does. So for me, I'm leaning into his wife counsel, right? We need confidants, we need counselors, but you also need a cheerleader. Who do you call when things are going well and they don't think you're bragging? They just celebrate, like, no, of course God's doing that. You're awesome. They're like your walk around hype music. Like, you just call them, like, I can do anything. Do you have that person? Who are you texting to say, you will not believe what God is doing here? We baptized three people. They're like, yeah. Why? Because they're for you. Because they're a friend. And they understand their role as a cheerleader. How about this? You need a collaborator. You need someone who's linking arms with you. Because we're better together. We are more effective in connection and community than we are in isolation. So here's the last one. And there's an asterisk. You need a cussing friend. Now, glad you're seated. Let me finish, okay? For the record, Psalms 19:14, good words of my mouth, meditation of my heart, be pleased to your sight alone, okay? Yeah, that's a life verse. Ephesians 4:29, do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouth, but only what's helpful. Okay, so we got that balance? You need people who you're like, I don't even have the right words. You're like, no, I don't think cussing is right. So it starts with B, that's why it's in there, okay? But what I'm saying is you need someone who you can have like a psalmist type conversation. Then it's like, I pray that you would gnash their teeth and that they would chew on gravel. That's kind of like cussing. And that is in the Bible, right? I think sometimes as a pastor, it's like, we don't give ourselves permission or others just to just be real and raw. And I'm not saying just, and never would we ever take the Lord's name in vain. I'm not even slightly. What I'm saying, though, is sometimes we carry stuff. They're like, I just need to let this out. I'm not talking about not using self-control. I'm actually saying there are times where I'm processing and I'm wrestling. And when I have an unfiltered friend, I can just like, and I don't cuss. I really don't. Very rarely when I'm golfing, and I don't even want to. I don't, okay? I give myself, I'll just stay safe room. I give myself one cuss word a month, okay? I will say this. I use January, February, and March back in December playing golf. So I'm like, okay? But you know what I'm talking about? We need people, friends, co-laborers, spouses, wingman, wingwoman, who is like, I can't even describe how I'm feeling. But it's not good. Instead of saying, oh, you're like, oh, what's the, a heart attack is tingling in the left arm? Man, your church needs you healthy. And that means you have people who, by the way, they're godly friends. So if you actually do start testing, they're like, bro, easy, that's not who you are. Kevin, that's not who you are, okay? is the question. What have you been holding on to that you need to start processing with a friend? Like, decide and be honest about that here. What better place than in this setting with other incredible godly people? Just go, I don't want to go alone. So I'm going to put myself now, finally. So I'm going to pray. I'm going to process with trusted friends. And I'm going to put myself finally in a position to pivot where I can actually shift. I got to break out of discouragement. I gotta move from, now it might be a little bit of a journey, but I gotta get to the place where I'm actually carrying the truth of God's word. I'm speaking life instead of speaking death. So I grew up on the peninsula over in Paulsville, Washington. And we lived in Vancouver when I was little, then we moved to Paulsville. And I love the Puget Sound. I love the water. I love everything about it. Whenever you cross that Tacoma Narrows Bridge, in fact, I think there's a picture here. When you cross the Tacoma Narrows Bridge, you see this majestic beauty. Isn't that awesome? That's on the Tacoma side, right? Right there in University Place. But when you cross the bridge, that you look underneath and it's, you know, several hundred feet up, and you're like, yeah, and it just looks so peaceful and tranquil. What you don't know is that there is a raging current going underneath that bridge. Here's why. Wherever the land narrows, Tacoma narrows, wherever it narrows, the current increases. So wherever there's more pressure in your life gets squeezed and you get kind of pinched in, and then you have that job, you have this job, and you're doing that, all of a sudden, the current, now here's the thing about a current, it's imperceptible to the human eye, but it's felt. And so what we have to do is ask ourselves, am I in the current that is causing me to drift towards who I want to be, who I am as a man of God, a woman of God? Am I drifting towards godliness and great leadership and kingdom-mindedness, or am I in a current that's causing me to go somewhere I don't want to go? So Glenn and my wife, Samoan, from Hawaii. So Hawaii is one of our favorite places. We were there on our 25th wedding anniversary, 3.5 years ago. Incredible. You know, like, when you get away, it doesn't have to be a long ways away, but you get away, you're like, by the way, if you haven't had one of those 1 day, 2 week, 6 day, you need to put one on a calendar. You know why? They don't calendar themselves. How many times have I got to August? I'm like, what? How? What is happening? So we're in Maui. And we're staying at this little resort. And we went to the ABC store. If you've ever been to Hawaii, you know, like every 6 feet is an ABC store, okay? They're all over. It's a little department, grocery. You can basically buy a house in there, right? Super expensive. So we bought 2 air mattresses, and I was voluntold to blow them up, so I blew them up, and I'm going to get that later. And so I don't know if you've ever got onto an air mattress fully sunscreen, but it's like a slip and slide, okay? So it's already like that, you know. So I held your wings, and she got on it, and then I finally, you know, several attempts later, was safely on my now totally wet air mattress, right? And we just kind of paddled out. And then we held hands. And it was just like this moment. And that lasted about 7 seconds. It's in a wave hand. I'm like, that is not relaxing. Not at all. We're like, we don't want to separate from each other. So we kind of said, how do we keep our air mattresses? Like, anytime a wave came, it would kind of push us apart, right? So how do we stay close, share this moment, and still relax? And so here's how I came up with it. So I threw my leg over her leg on her air mattress, and we weathered that wave. I highlight there, I felt it, you know? And she's already just, she says, you can't do that. We did it. We're still together. Put my leg over your leg. We didn't separate. She's like, you can't do that. I'm like, why? She said, I'm going to get a tan line. To which I responded, you're already brown. Okay? With that said, I ended up with a tan line, and because her leg went over top of mine, but we finally found a position where we could stay together, not her legs over mine, and I don't really care, honestly, but. And it was one of those, I'm serious, it was one of those, peace. The wind, warm, the water's comfortable. I don't they bring you somewhere. And so then I got off mine and I swam us back. That was fun. Listen, you put yourself in a current being here this week. Way to go. Honestly, it's like you're just strategically engaging. If you want to pivot and you're dealing with discouragement, you've got to ask, what currents am I in regularly? And sometimes currents are relationships, and you're like, man, every time I'm around them, I feel encouraged. You need to figure out how to get into that current more. But you also have to be honest. Sometimes we're with people or we're in settings, you're like, kind of want to kick a puppy after hanging out with them. Like, I'm not for that, okay? I'm not for that. You know what I'm talking about? It's just like put yourself in a place. Come on, pastors. No one can do that for you. But you can. And so you say, I'm gonna set my intention, put myself in a position to pivot, to drift into the currents of where I want to go. I love what the Bible says. I finish with this. Psalms 43. I'm going to hit 43 and then go back to 42. He says, why am I so discouraged? This is David. And he's either writing because Absalom is like usurping his authority or because King Saul will let him go to the temple. Either way, he's dealing with major internal strife. Okay? And he says, like, why am I discouraged? He didn't deny it. I love that he recognizes, he acknowledges it. Why is my heart so sad? And maybe that's exactly how you feel right now today. No, I mean, you look great. But you know what's happening on the inside. Why is my heart so sad? And then what he does is he pivots. He makes a decision in this moment. He said, I'm going to put my hope in God. What do you do, though, when you don't have the strength or the stamina to flip your own switch? That's why you need the confidant, cheerleader, collaborator, right? That's why you need those sisters and brothers. I will put my hope in God. I will praise Him again. Prayer is an expression of praise. Because I recognize I'm not God. My Savior, my God. And then Psalms 42. Why so downcast, oh my soul? Listen, if God saw fit to have the writer put this in there, he's saying, listen, you may deal with some discouragement along the way, too. He's like, why so downcast on my soul? And again, he decides, I'm going to pivot, and I'm going to put myself in a place. He said, put your hope in God. Listen, all of us, if you're not dealing with discouragement today, we celebrate that with you. We really do. If you're in the best season of life and ministry, man, let this be a room of cheerleaders. Of people just saying, yeah, come on, I love that. And, not but, and,
love that. What current are you allowing yourself to be in, and where is it carrying you? And I love the fifth point, trusting. That was good. Who would have thought that?
I forgot to mention this. If you don't have a trusting friend, you are that trusting friend.
Okay. That's good. Hey, we're going to take a 15-minute break so you can grab some coffee or use the restroom. So 10:15, come back, and we'll start again.